board, but I'm going to place them on if we do. And sit down.
Welcome, welcome.
By the way, I'm Steve Watcher, president of the Milwaukee chapter of the United Nations Association. We often have a business meeting as part of these, and we talk about, you know, the finances in and out, etc. We're going to just suspend that for today, in fact, until November, because we have such a special speaker, and we want to have full time for discussion. So, in fact, Peter Wesley is showing a PowerPoint, but he's actually going to not do that, and so that there's more time for discussion, and etc. So, we're really pleased to have such an expert on the UN, the UNA, the State Department, U.S. diplomacy, especially Africa, which he's just returned from. So we're just we're so fortunate to have a great speaker like Peter to talk to us today. And so Annette is going to do the major introduction of Peter Yeo. Let me just say a few things. As I was looking around the internet to see what kind of stuff he'd been up to, I found that he'd written articles on all kinds of different things about peacekeeping and the U.S. troops, you know, U.S. and U.N. troops doing peacekeeping, all kinds of diplomatic efforts. He has some expertise about Haiti, about Mali, about different aspects of Africa, including AIDS programs in Africa. He had something to say about the Iran nuclear deal, has things to say about ISIL. And so, you know, how could we, you know, properly put it all out on the flyer? So we just didn't. But he's an expert on a bunch of things. One reason we wanted to have him come now is that, you know, we're entering the election season, and it's not going to be an election pitch, but, you know, the relation of the U.S. to the U.N. and to the whole rest of the world is a really hot topic, more so than usual, maybe more so than in the last 4 years. And so to have someone who knows what the U.N. is doing and what the U.S. Congress is doing in regards to it, maybe what the possibilities will be after the election, which way it could go, what we can do about it, what our chapter, what our members, what anybody in Wisconsin could do to help promote the U.N. and its goals. Peter's the best person we could think of to do some of those things. Just related to that, I guess, it's not going to be a rah-rah speech for the U.N. because Peter's actually testified in front of Congress about reform efforts, about some problems, some things that need to be improved with the U.N. He'll also be talking about the next Secretary of General, so there's some excitement about that. So, having given that little bit of introduction, let me introduce the introducer. Annette, would you come forward?
So Steve asked me to introduce Peter, and my mother said, of course, because really, he's your guest. You contacted him, and I said, okay. Normally, I would just say a word or two offhanded and a little funny anecdote, but I think it's really important to read to you this short bio because of his experience. But first, I want to say that he is a Wisconsinite, and he is a former MUNer. And he sent me an email this week and said, I'm really excited about the UNSIL, United Nations Schools for International Learning, with MPS because I'm an MUNer, and that was a great turning point in my life. And he holds Wisconsin in his heart. So he came today to speak to all of you, but this is going to be a greater far-reaching reason and experience for all of us and for him, because he's later going to be able to talk to Michelle Wade and Jenny Eckstein, and connect with Ann Terrell, and possibly Dr. Driver at MPS. So we're really thrilled about this strong connection. As president of the Better World Campaign and vice president for public policy and advocacy at the United Nations Foundation, Peter leads the foundation's strategic engagement with Congress and the administration to advance policy changes that support the UN's work for global progress. Under Yeo's leadership, the foundation has helped ensure multi-billion dollar payments from the U.S. government to the U.N., forged a strategic alliance with the United Nations Association of the USA to create the largest network of U.N. supporters across the U.S., championed U.S. law standing against child marriage with the support of Girl Up, and advanced year-over-year increases in U.S. bilateral and multilateral global health spending. Peter joined the United Nations Foundation and the Better World Campaign in 2009 with over 20 years of legislative, analytical, and management experience, including senior roles on Capitol Hill and in the State Department. Prior to arriving at UNF, Yeo served for 10 years as the Deputy Staff Director at the House Foreign Affairs Committee, chaired by Representative Tom Lanio Lantos of Democrat California and Representative Howard Berman, D, Democrat California. He has worked on a broad range of foreign policy and foreign aid issues. On behalf of the House Foreign Affairs Committee Democrats, he led the successful negotiations for the landmark HIV-AIDS, AIDS, Tuberculosis and Malaria Act of 2003, commonly known as PFPFAR, the acronym, as well as the successful $50 billion reauthorization of the law in 2008. I'm almost at the end. He also shepherded into law several measures dealing with China, Tibet, Burma, and East Timor. Prior to his work with the committee, he served as a Deputy Assistant Secretary at the U.S. State Department during the second Clinton administration, where he led the negotiations around repayment of the U.S. arrears to the United Nations and was part of the U.S. delegation to the climate negotiations of Kyoto. Yeo holds a BA in East Asian Studies from Wesleyan University, as well as an MA in East Asian Studies from Harvard. He is also a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, a leading independent nonpartisan foreign policy think tank, and a board member of the U.S. Global Leadership Coalition. Please help me to welcome Peter.
Well, thank you so much, Joan. Thank you, Steve, for having me today. It's a real pleasure to be here in Milwaukee. And Joan, thank you for your support for this new UNSIL. I think it's fantastic. The model UN are in me, as I think about my career, my interest in foreign policy, it was completely derivative of the fact that I was a model UNer in high school and went to National Model UN representing Mozambique, and which, by the way, at the time, wasn't so good a country to represent because they were part of the Soviet bloc. So the Soviet ambassador would tell us how to vote, and then we'd have to do what he told us to do. But as I said, it is just fantastic to be back here in Milwaukee. When I think about my career, when I think about my family, and to think about how I've been involved in politics, Milwaukee is at its core. I am a proud graduate of Shorewood High School, as I said, a model UNer. I was very involved in politics growing up, and Milwaukee really welcomed young people being involved in politics. So I was involved in presidential campaigns and governed Udall, Jimmy Carter. I was involved in the Young Democrats of Milwaukee. I did anti-draft registration rallies. I was involved in I was telling Anita we worked very closely with the Young Socialists. But I did Wisconsin Supreme Court races, county commissioner races, state house races, Congressman Royce's re-election race. So I was involved from age 3 until I went to college in Milwaukee politics. And it has absolutely allowed me to thrive in terms of my career. And also, you know, the hard work tradition here in Milwaukee. I grew up with the Milwaukee Journal paper out. And my father owned Vicky's Ice Cream in the Plankington Mall. And so I had jobs throughout middle and high school working at Vicky's Ice Cream. And of course, throughout the whole process, my parents have been core to it. My father was very involved in the foundation community and was pastor over Plymouth. And my mother was very involved in the women's reproductive health debate and community here in Milwaukee. It is a real pleasure to be back here today. So, Steve and Annette, you posed a very provocative question, which is, does the U.S. still need the United Nations? And I'm going to give you the quick answer, which is yes, and now more than ever. But I'd like to take today's remarks to walk you through my thinking about why the U.S. still needs the U.N., on peace and security issues, on development issues, on humanitarian issues, and most importantly, on environmental issues. And then it seems to me that the UN is being asked to do more than it's ever been asked to do. And frankly, not just by the US, but by other countries as well. But its future has never been more challenged. And so we as advocates for the UN need to understand this. We need to understand the complexities of the UN. The UN is operating in countries that nobody else wants to operate in. By the time the United Nations gets to these countries, everybody else is gone. And the UN is there leading the way. So it's very difficult at the end of the day to have a red ribbon on the top of the UN's involvement around the world and say, that was an A+. Because these are very challenging environments. But we need to collectively understand the complexities of the UN's work so that we can better talk to our friends, our neighbors, our policymakers about the UN's very important contributions. So if you don't mind, I'm going to jump right in and look at the headlines that we're all reading about or we're all seeing on the television and understand how the UN is central to the solutions. The first one I'm going to highlight is the climate change agreement. Just last Saturday, President Obama, it was in China, signing the joint U.S.-Chinese participation in the UN's climate change accord. Now, this is fantastic news. These are the two largest polluters in the world agreeing to take meaningful action to stop greenhouse gas emissions. And this is vitally important. You all are the first generation to actually feel the impact of climate change. We know it's happening. It's happening. And we all are collectively the last generation that can take meaningful steps to stop climate change from occurring. That's what this agreement is about. And it frankly wouldn't have happened without the United Nations. It wouldn't have happened if the UN hadn't been there to convene everybody again and again and again to work out this agreement. It wouldn't have happened if the Secretary General of the UN, Ban Ki-moon, had not used his good offices and his public posture to continue to force the process for this agreement. And it wouldn't have happened without a whole host of senior UN officials from around the world that made the creation of the Paris Agreement their top priority. And so the UN is at the core of climate change. Well, refugees. Now, we all couldn't miss it when we saw the picture of Omran Dagnish, the little boy in the back of the ambulance. And as a father, and I'm sure all of you out there as parents and all of you out there as individuals, it just takes your breath away when you see the boy in the back of the ambulance with blood on his face, with nobody taking care of him. And it just, this whole issue about Syria, it causes one to question the value of the UN. I get it. Why can't the countries of the world use the UN to stop the conflict in Syria? And there's a lot of reasons for it, Russia being number one. But I think when you look at what's happened in Syria and the response to Syria, it's also a statement of hope in terms of what the UN is doing. There are 16 million refugees from Syria who are largely being cared for by the United Nations, UNICEF, the UN Refugee Agency, the UN Population Fund. So these refugees, in fact, many of them would never have fled to Europe if there had been greater resources provided to them in the various places where they're living, in Jordan, in Lebanon, in Turkey. And somebody told me that a key reason why a lot of the Syrians fled to Europe was they suddenly realized over the last couple of years that their kids weren't going to get a good education. They might get a basic education, but they weren't going to get a good education in the refugee situation, so that's why they moved to Europe. And frankly, all of us as parents probably make a similar decision. North Korea. Wow, okay, so yesterday they conducted their fifth nuclear test. South Korea is very much on edge. Well, the UN Security Council is the key forum to try to resolve the North Korean human rights for the North Korean nuclear situation. It hasn't succeeded yet, but there are the toughest ever sanctions that have been placed on North Korea that have buy-in from China, from Russia, and other key countries because of the Security Council. It's going to take time to have this pressure bear fruit and hopefully move North Korea away from the nuclear brink. But this, no matter how you look at the solutions, the UN Security Council is going to be key to making it happen. Zika. Well, while Congress has been fiddling as Rome is burning in terms of actually an American response to Zika, the UN has been hard at work. The World Health Organization is coordinating the global response to Zika, both in Latin America, in the Caribbean, and in North America. UNICEF is providing direct assistance to the families who have kids that have been born with microcephaly, and the International Atomic Energy Agency, of all things, is providing some very important research in terms of trying to tackle the issue of mosquitoes transmitting Zika. So, as you see, the issues that we're dealing with, North Korea, Zika, the front page news, the UN is certainly front and center in terms of the solution. And former Secretary of State Madeleine Albright once called the U.S. the indispensable nation. Well, I also feel that the UN is the indispensable global institution. There are other important organizations out there, NATO, ASEAN, the African Union, all of which play important roles. But if you think about the global challenges that all countries around the world face, the UN is the absolute place to go to try to work through these important issues. In fact, if the UN didn't exist, we would certainly have to create it. So I'd like to talk about a few issues that are not in the headlines, and particularly peacekeeping and the UN's work with kids. Because I think we need to understand both how they're on the front end of the crisis, but they're working day in, day out, behind the scenes in a way that just is not noticed. So peacekeeping. I was in South Sudan last year, and that is a mission that has learned from past mistakes. When you think about Rwanda and Srebrenica, where civilians were not protected by the UN, this is a case where the 200,000 South Sudanese are being protected by UN peacekeepers. They are the thin blue line that protects these civilians from armed militias, from their own government, all of whom are out to attack and kill them. 200,000 civilians being protected by peacekeepers. It didn't start this way. South Sudan 5 years ago was a brand new country. There was so much promise. The U.S. had invested a generation in making South Sudan an independent country. But leave it to the men. They immediately fell into fighting. And 3 years ago, there was a civil war broke out, not over principle, not over policy, just who was going to be in charge. And as a result of the decisions made by these two men, we have seen hundreds of thousands of people displaced in that country, tens of thousands of people killed. It's just horrible. Well, the UN, it wasn't set up to accommodate 200,000 people, but it did so anyways. It opened its doors, people started running into the camps, and the UN has been there protecting them. So when I was there, people were still coming. I met a young woman who had been forced out of her village because of horrible things happening back in the village due to militias. She walked 5 days to get to the camp. She started the trip with two kids. By the time she showed up at the camp, she had one. One had died along the way. There was another woman we met who had taken a similar track. She had been raped along the way, and when the minute she showed up at the camp, they had taken her baby away because the baby was on death's door. And so while we were standing there, they reunited her with her baby, who had been rehydrated. And you know, the look on her face was exactly what you'd expect any mother to look when she got reunited with her baby, that she didn't know was going to survive or not. This is what people are doing to get to these sites that are being maintained by the UN peacekeepers, because what's happening back in the villages is even worse. And once they get there, they are being protected and fed and clothed by the UN. So, by UNICEF, by the World Health Organization. So, this is a case in South Sudan where important civilian protection is happening because of peacekeepers. I got back from DR Congo just a few weeks ago. It's the largest country by geography in sub-Saharan Africa. It is the fifth poorest country in the world. The peacekeepers in Congo are dealing with a very different type of situation. You all recall the Rwandan genocide. Well, there was some people that lost that battle. They all moved to eastern Congo, and they have created an enormous destabilized situation in eastern Congo, where tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people have been forced from their homes in eastern Congo. Most teenagers are conscripted. They're taken from their families and forced into one militia or another. So we met with some of these kids that were being demobilized by the UN. And there, the peacekeepers, it's a very different mission than South Sudan, because they are working with the government of Congo to take offensive military action to defeat the militias that are destabilizing the situation. Because if you don't deal with these militias, people can't return home. And if people can't return home, then you will continue to have instability, extreme poverty in eastern Congo. And so while we were there, we actually took a Russian helicopter and flew up to a remote base that was being protected by Uruguayan peacekeepers. So they're UN peacekeepers from Uruguay, because the US doesn't attribute peacekeepers. And we met with some villagers, and they said, thank God the peacekeepers are here. If you look at those hills behind here, in fact, you will see that there are people out there that want to kill us. The peacekeepers are protecting us. But then we met with the people who lived in that area, and they said, we want the refugees to go home. They're living on our land. So it's a very complex situation, and the UN is trying to sort this all out and make sure that people can go home over time. So I think that peacekeeping is sort of an untold story about the UN's success, but I think the UN's work with children is another untold story. When I was in Congo, we visited two facilities being run by UNICEF. Both of these facilities are designed to deal with kids that have been tossed out of their homes because of a variety of beliefs. If bad luck comes to a family, they assume that one of the kids brought the bad luck. So they toss them out of their homes onto the street, and that's where the UN comes in, using your taxpayer dollars that we give to UNICEF. They had one home for girls where they actually had beds to sleep in, and they were fed. And then UNICEF works to find other relatives that will take them so that they don't have to live there forever. The boys, they couldn't afford it, so they were living on the streets. I saw a 6-year-old boy, and I said, well, who watches out after you? And he pointed to a 10-year-old boy. So the 10-year-old watches out after the 6-year-old. And the UNICEF people are making sure that they get a shower, there's some basic food, and that somebody calls the relatives to convince a relative to take them. That's what the UN is doing with your taxpayers' dollars. UNHCR is making an effort to make sure that refugee kids get an education. The United Nations Association of the U.S. has just launched a new initiative called Adopt the Future that allows individual UNA chapters to adopt a school in a refugee camp and to make sure that those kids get the books and the education they need. So I would really encourage all UNA chapters to participate in Adopt the Future. And throughout Africa and throughout the world, when you think about kids being vaccinated against life-threatening diseases, vaccinations that we all get normally as part of our healthcare here, 58% of the world's kids are being vaccinated by the United Nations, 58%.
Wow.
So when you think about that, about UNICEF and the World Health Organization, polio, measles, that's a lot of work. And I'll just give you an example. Polio. We have reduced polio by 99.9% as a result of a collaboration between the United Nations, Rotary International, United Nations Foundation, Gates Foundation, working together. 99.9% reduction. This year, we've only had 24 cases of polio. And hopefully, watch this space, in the first quarter of 2017, we will see zero. So this could be the first disease eliminated since smallpox almost 50 years ago. So this is a real exciting moment, but there's so much work that needs to get done between now and then to hold on to these gains to make sure that we can really defeat polio. And it would not happen without the reach of the United Nations. So let me just take a pause for a second about these headline stories and these untold stories to echo a point that Steve made, which is that I don't want to be solely a cheerleader for the United Nations and for a strong American relationship with the UN. The UN is a challenging institution. It has 193 members, all of whom think that they're sort of the boss of something. So if you can imagine trying to run any institution with 193 board members, you wouldn't get anything done. So it's amazing that the UN gets anything done with 193 member states. But the UN also desperately needs reform. And if it doesn't reform, it's going to be increasingly hobbled for years to come. The system whereby individual jobs in the UN are sort of shuffled around based upon countries and regions is debilitating. It means that sometimes the best person for the job doesn't get the job. Transparency. The UN is sometimes guided by some of its member states that don't like sharing things in a way that we do in the United States. So transparency is a challenge for the UN, and they've got to fix it. Sexual exploitation and abuse by peacekeepers. This is a huge issue these days. There needs to be better command and control of people that are participating in peacekeeping missions. There needs to be better troops, and there needs to be justice so that victims feel that there's a recourse. And if somebody is participating in this, they need to be repatriated and taken out of that country immediately. And the same as it relates to protecting civilians. The same camps that I visited in South Sudan, there was 25 civilians that were killed in one of the camps because the government came in and started shooting people. Why didn't the peacekeepers act more quickly to protect those 25? So it's an issue. It's not a perfect record. And the budgetary situation, one of the challenges is, and my friend from Congressman Moody's office from way back when will understand this, that this tendency sometimes, as opposed to sunsetting programs that are no longer necessary, to just create new programs. Well, you know, this is a tough budget situation, so you have to make some hard choices at times. And thirdly, I know it's not always easy to sell America's engagement with the UN to our friends and our neighbors. We have plenty of problems here at home. But I think the one thing I always want to stress is that America, in terms of its total foreign aid budget, including our participation in the UN, is less than 1% of the total federal budget. Less than 1%. So as you think about balancing the federal budget, which needs to get done, you really can't do it in terms of our engagement with the world. So despite these challenges, I think it's important, it's all the more recent, to think about the future of the United Nations. And it's also more important that the U.S. be a leader in the U.S., in the United Nations. Because the reality is, we're a force for good within that organization. Whether it's a Democratic or Republican administration, a Democratic or Republican Congress, we have got to stay engaged. We have got to demand reform. We've got to demand leadership. And here's the good news. We have this great new framework that is guiding the UN's work. It's guiding all of our work for the next 15 years. And those are called the Sustainable Development Goals. Now, I was a skeptic at the beginning of this process. When they said there were 17 goals, I thought, well, that's just too many, right? 17 goals doesn't mean anything. But here's what's exciting. These 17 goals that end extreme poverty over the next 15 years, promote efforts to end inequality, protect the global environment, these 17 goals actually have the buy-in of 193 countries. which is something that the Millennium Development Goals that they replaced never had. So these are goals that have the buy-in of every country in the world, and that is a significant achievement. And most importantly, they have American buy-in. We at the United Nations Association of the U.S. did consultations in 50 different places around the U.S. to hear what you all thought the Sustainable Development Goals should reflect. And there was one consultation in Milwaukee. And as a result, we took that information, we fed it to the U.S. negotiators. And as a result, the new Sustainable Development Goals largely reflect our priorities. And that's wonderful. It means that there's an internal buy-in. And we were so worried, frankly, that some of our Republican friends on Capitol Hill would go after these goals because they were from the UN. We spent the last 3 years working on Capitol Hill, bringing in the Republicans in Congress. And so recently, we just had the chairman of the House Foreign Affairs Committee, who represents Orange County, California, a pretty conservative place. And he gave a speech with the Secretary General in Los Angeles, in which he spent half of the speech talking about how awesome the Sustainable Development Goals were. So I think there's bipartisan possibilities here. But I think that one thing that we have these new goals, but we now need a new leader at the United Nations to guide us through these goals. Because Ban Ki-moon, the current Secretary General, his term ends in January 2017. So the next Secretary General, assuming that she's reelected, will be guiding the first 10 years of the Sustainable Development Goals. So we need a new Secretary General who is competent, who is qualified, who's inspirational, who can get stuff done. And we have 10 candidates who are currently being considered for this new job. Now, at the beginning of the process, the goal was to make sure the person was from Eastern Europe, because Eastern Europe had never had a Secretary General. And the goal was to have a woman. And the goal was to have a more open process than has ever happened before. We just don't know how it's going to play out. The process is strange. It's the Security Council does these straw polls where they don't write the name of their country on top. And then they pass around the little notes, and then you encourage some candidates, you discourage other candidates. At the moment, the leading candidate is from Portugal, Antonio Guterres. He's getting the most votes. And he's a former head of the UN Refugee Agency. He's a great speaker, not from Eastern Europe, not a woman. But not necessarily a bad choice either, in the sense that he's been on the global stage, he's worked within the UN system, he knows how to get stuff done. But here's what we don't know. We don't know if the five permanent members of the Security Council, you know, UK, Russia, the US, France, I'm missing one. China, thank you. Whether they are going to veto any of the candidates. So we'll know, starting in October, when Russia chairs the Security Council, whether there will be vetoes against any of these candidates. There are still women in the race. Susana Malcora from Argentina, Irina Bokova from Bulgaria. And then just yesterday, I heard a new rumor, which is that a very prominent Bulgarian woman, Kristalina Georgieva, who was a prominent minister in the European Union, that she might be officially nominated as soon as next week, which would be great news for us because we know her. So we'll see how this plays out. I just think it's important that we remember that we just need a good, competent Secretary General that is inspirational, that can lead us. And from my perspective, I certainly hope it's a woman, because when you look at these candidates, there are some good women candidates to be part of that. So this is, in fact, the first time since President Eisenhower that we will have a new Secretary General and a new President of the United States at the same time. So it is certainly a moment to think about how we can have an even more productive relationship between the U.S. and the U.N. So I'd like to end my discussion, and I look forward to taking all of your questions, with an answer to another provocative question that you all posed, which was, would the Senate today ratify the U.N. Charter? So would today's Senate ratify the U.N. Charter? And the answer in the current political situation is no. And the best example of this is that last year, 2 years ago, there was a UN treaty that was put up for vote. It made sure that people who were disabled had equal rights. Seemingly a slam dunk, right? They brought former Senator Bob Dole to the floor, who's disabled in a wheelchair, and he watched his former colleagues vote against the treaty. And so, you know, it seems to me that even despite the fact that the UN is actually very popular with the American public, 80% of Americans want the US to remain engaged with the UN. 60% have a favorable impression of the UN, which is slightly higher than Congress. Point that out all the time, but sort of true. So this anti-UN that sometimes is reflected by policymakers, frankly, is not reflective of where the American public is. But that's where we all come in. As Americans, as activists, as advocates, as citizens, you know, we need to, over the long term, convince policymakers that working with other countries as opposed to going it alone is the preferred solution. And that means writing letters to our policymakers, not once, but every year. It means attending lobby days, both in Washington and meeting with your elected representatives here in Milwaukee or Madison. It means using social media to contact them. I am constantly struck by how most members of Congress personally check their Twitter accounts all day long. So if you want to communicate with your member of Congress, tweet at them. It means letters to the editor. It means telling your neighbors and spreading the word about the important work of the UN. It means getting young people involved. So thank you all for coming today. And I'm going to give you a heads up about a new initiative that we are launching on Monday. So you know about it for everybody else. So it's called Vote Like the World Depends on It. And because it certainly does. So if you go to www.voteftw.org, FTW stands for the win, .org, you can check it out. And take the graphic that you'll see there, take the messaging, share it on your social media, because our goal is to make sure that millennial voters who may be disaffected, maybe cynical, and I speak as the father of two millennial voters, so I get it. I have one who's really involved in politics. I have one that I can't even talk to about politics because he thinks it's all corrupt. So I get it. I understand it. But we're trying to make sure that people, that young millennials who care about global issues, malaria, vaccines, America's role in the UN, global LGBT rights, name your favorite global issue, that you understand that there's a stake in this election to what happens on those issues, and it is important that we vote. We at the UN Foundation don't have a stake as to which way to vote, but we want people to recognize the global implications of what's happening here. So I certainly hope that we can return to a political situation where the UN Charter could be ratified, along with a lot of other important treaties, including the Treaty on the Rights of the Disabled, the Convention to End All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, Law of the Sea, all of which stand unratified by the United States Senate. And that's what the men and women that were part of the U.S. delegation to the UN Charter Convention in San Francisco 71 years ago wanted us to do. They knew full well that once we created the UN, that we would have to continue to stay engaged, not just at the governmental and leadership level, but at the citizens level. So we can be the people that make this happen again. So thank you for inviting me. Thank you for listening. I'd love to answer any questions right now.
We're not done. We actually have 45 minutes for questions this time, which is more than usual. We have quite a few topics that you could ask about. So given the size of the crowd, which is 70-some people, if you can kind of come up forward, we'll put you on the mic if it doesn't squeak, just so that everybody can hear. So
I can repeat your question.
Or that.
Yeah, I'll repeat the question.
Okay. Well, Myrtle, since you went to the effort, do you want to either come up or just shout your question? We'll let you go first.
Oh.
But don't stand in front of the camera or John will talk to you.
My question is, since several of the UN organizations have accepted the membership of Palestine, causing the United States to drop the membership in them, could you give us the current situation of that? Which organizations have accepted Palestine and causing the U.S. to drop their membership?
There's a tough issue. Whatever the UN does, somebody will complain, but here we go.
The question is, Palestine has joined some UN organizations, and as a result of longstanding American law, the U.S. has been forced to stop funding those organizations. At the moment, the only organization that we have been forced to stop funding is UNESCO. So the U.S. has not provided funding to UNESCO for the past 4 years as a result of the decision to make Palestine a full member. Palestine has joined several other treaty bodies, but because of the technicalities of the law, it hasn't forced a cutoff in any funding. So at the moment, it's just UNESCO. But the Obama administration made an effort to change the law, and so we're certainly hoping that the next administration will make an effort to change the law as well.
Okay, by the way. Let's see if one of the students has a question, because we like to do that. Here's one right here, and we can give you the mic. Come on up a little bit closer, though, because you can't stand in front of the speaker or you're in trouble.
What do you mean with the first generation of climate change?
That's a good question. I believe that the question is, what do we mean by the fact that they're the first generation to feel the effects of climate change? When you look at the dramatic impact and evidence over the past 5 to 10 years of rising of the impact in terms of the ice melt, in terms of both North Arctic and Antarctica, the rising sea levels, the changing of the weather patterns that are measurable and noticeable all through the world as a result of the changing climate. And, of course, the steadily rising temperatures that you can notice on a year-to-year basis, we now have evidence that 99% of the world's climatologists believe that we are seeing the impacts of climate change in a way that I didn't feel them and see them as a kid, and you're seeing now. So you are the first generation that is actually seeing the impact of climate change. But you're also the first generation that can fix it.
Unless other folks left, you're going to try to. John, why don't we give you a chance?
I just would like to have...
could I ask you to step back? Sorry. Thank you.
Vote on the internet, as you said. Vote SPW something.
Sure. Yeah. So the question is about this new initiative we have. It's called... The internet is www.voteftw.org. FTW, for the young people in the room who know the answer already, is for the win. So voteftw.org. And the name of the campaign is called Vote Like the World Depends on It.
Thank you.
Phil, I see you got an active arm there. Shout it out. You don't have to come forward, though. I'll repeat it.
As a fellow Charlotte graduate, I am honored by your distinguished presence here. I have a question. Is the United Nations Foundation, does it have the power to change the idea of the veto? I think five countries that were the good guys 71 years ago do not have an eternal right to do that. It seems to me that X number of countries, a coalition, none of which have an active resolution against them, might make more sense.
Thank you very much. So you heard the issue, which is it possible that the UN Foundation could be involved in Security Council reform? We do convenings in New York with member states around certain issues, and we have done some work in the past as it relates to Security Council reform. It is imperative that the governments themselves understand why the Security Council needs to be reformed. I'm not saying it's an easy task. Nobody gives up power easily. And so, you know, the US and Russia and China are looking at it saying, why am I giving up the veto? What's in it for me? And what we need to convince those countries is that what's in it for you is the credibility of the United Nations. And the credibility of the UN is threatened when five countries can hold up everything, including an effective response to what's happening in Syria. I mean, you know, the situation in Syria has been completely exacerbated because one country will repeatedly veto any effort to do meaningful action to stop the violence in Syria, and that's Russia. And so it's important that we think about Security Council reform. We at the Foundation use our neutral convening power to try to bring member states together around these issues, because one of the things that we try not to do in the UN system is make ourselves a decision maker. I mean, this is ultimately a member states have to be the decision makers here, but we try to bring the decision makers together towards solving these challenges. But it's a great, good question.
Just before we take that one, let me do a little more survey thing. Can I ask how many people knew Peter or his father or mother when they lived in Milwaukee many years ago?
I'm sorry.
Right, let's see if there's another.
If you could either
question,
step aside. Or,
right,
yeah, thanks.
What do you mean by vote by the word against on?
That's a great question. So the question is, what do we mean by vote like the world depends on it? What we mean is that when you look at the individual candidates, there are some candidates that want to engage with the rest of the world. There are some candidates that want to come up with broadly accepted solutions to the world's challenges, whether it's global warming, whether it's hunger, whether it's the way the kids are being treated. And so there are some candidates that want to go it alone and don't want to work with other countries and might want to denigrate certain people as one way or the other. So there are candidates on both sides, and we want everybody to vote and look at global issues when they make their decision, however that decision goes.
All right, over on this side of the room.
Okay, now you had mentioned that, as many of us in this room know, how the United States Senate today no doubt would not ratify the United Nations Charter, much less CEDAW and the Charter on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, the International Charter on the Rights of the Child, and so forth. Despite how, as you've said, 80% of the American people support the American involvement in the UN, 60% think the UN is good and useful, why do you think there is so little, if any, visible voter outrage at how these senators are basically thumbing their noses at the American people and at common sense?
By the way, if you get our newsletter, our excellent newsletter, edited by Gary, who's over there, there he is, there's a comment on that Treaty on Disabilities in our local politician, so one more reason to become a member, so you get the newsletter.
So the question is, why are people more outraged that why are people more outraged that our policymakers are not supporting globally accepted treaties, whether it's disabled or CEDAW, and I think that
It's American exceptionalism.
Well, yeah, I think that the people aren't outraged because most people vote on other issues. They tend to vote on domestic issues, education, the roads, name your favorite domestic social issue, and trust of the candidates. And so when it comes to global affairs, it tends not to be always on the top of people's priority list. But it should be, and I think that this election is somewhat different. There's a lot of focus on this election on global issues, yeah, on America's role in the world, because there are very two different viewpoints being accepted, being proposed. So I'm hoping that this outrage comes back. And I do think that there has been some blowback for those senators who voted against the disability convention among some of their constituents. So I'm still hoping. But I think it has to do with the fact that most Americans generally tend not to vote on global issues. This is unfortunate.
You know, I teach sociology at METC, and I make the students write a letter to an elected official, and I give them the whole range of possible elected officials and issues, hoping that they'll take up some world thing, which we spend half the course on. I have to tell you, the most common one is potholes.
I don't like potholes either.
Right, of course, potholes, really. Let's give somebody in the back of the room a chance. How about over here? Just shout it out. We'll repeat the question.
Really basic information I'm looking for. If you could give an explanation on what the peacekeepers are, their training, et cetera, et cetera. There's been a lot of press within the past few years about them abusing their authority, but then also them being abused. So just an explanation regarding how you would become a peacekeeper, training, all that sort of thing.
So the question is, what are the basic elements, how do people become peacekeepers, and what is the training that they receive? There are 125,000 peacekeepers around the world. What the UN does is it goes to the militaries around the world and says, can you send us peacekeepers? So the largest countries that contribute peacekeepers are Nepal, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh. The US has 100. And so most of these countries contribute battalions. Some of them are well trained, and then some of them aren't. The UN makes an effort to try to make sure that the best troops are trained, but frankly, there aren't enough peacekeepers being offered up. So the UN is frequently in the position of taking troops that are not the premier troops. And as a result, you have bad command and control, and you have poorly trained troops, sometimes, that do bad things to the civilian population. I think 99% of peacekeepers do their job with valor and with strength and dignity, but you know, it's the 1%. But I think it's also important to remember that, you know, just this over the past 2 years, 55 UN peacekeepers have died in Mali. They're fighting terrorism in Mali on behalf of the United Nations, and they're dying as a result of it. So we have a lot of brave peacekeepers. My favorite story is an American peacekeeper who was serving in South Sudan just when the civil war broke out 3 years ago. And so the government came to the camp that he was guarding, and he was running the camp, and they said, hand over all the men. And we've been there before. When militias say hand over all the men, you know, bad things happen. And, you know, and he refused. He stood in the door and he said, absolutely not, you may not have them. And it was a real brave action by this American who did this. And, you know, eventually they backed off. And he could get reinforcements, and he was able to save these people. So, you know, there is bravery that happens. I get the stories, I've seen them. And a lot of the negativity on some of the peacekeepers, it's ultimately up to the individual country that contributes the troops to train them and to equip them. There's no UN standing army. And so it's a little bit hodgepodge, and that's not a good thing. I bet peacekeepers who are just top-notch, that you would trust, you know, guarding it, guarding the family, and then I've got peacekeepers, yeah, not so much. So it's mixed bag.
By the way, the U.S. just, you know, doesn't send troops to a lot of places in the world where you might think, geez, we could use some peacekeeping because, well, it might be inflammatory. And so if we didn't have the United Nations, we'd have to invent it. The U.S. pays about 28% of the budget for the peacekeeping. We get a pretty good return on the dollar for that without having to risk our own troops and then possibly risk inflaming the situation. Peter is too modest to say. He actually testified in front of Congress about some problems with the peacekeepers and how we need to do a whole lot better on the peacekeepers abusing the people they're supposed to be protecting. Let's go over to Mary.
I have heard on the news about Syria having this drought for 4 years, from 2006 to 2010, I think it was. And then they got Abbas. They voted on Abbas, I guess, and they got him. But he didn't do it about climate, about the drought, about the climate change, really, that's happening in the Middle East. So my question is, and nobody really talks about it on the news or anything, that this was really, it sounds like it was really the instigation for a lot of the refugees coming. So my question is, can you talk about what the UN is doing about that sort of problem that is really, I wonder how much of the migration that we're seeing is really due to climate change rather than the wars that follow the climate change.
Thank you. So the question is, to what extent is climate change a driver in refugee flows that we're seeing not only out of Syria but more broadly? I think I might separate out the two. I think that generally, it is true that when you look at most refugees in the world, most refugees in the world are not from Syria. Most refugees in the world are from a variety of African countries where they've been forced out. And in many circumstances, the conflicts that drove them to become refugees or internally displaced people have been exacerbated by climate change because of desertification, because of lack of access to water, lack of access to food, because crops failed due to changing climate patterns. So it is unquestionable that climate is a driver in refugee flows. I think in the context of Syria, I think that the ability of countries like Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon, who are hosting most of the refugees, is only been taxed by the fact that they themselves are dealing with climate change and the impact of climate change. So they're less wealthy nations, they're less well-off nations because they're trying to tackle a changing climate and what it means for their own resources, whether it's water resources or arable land for agriculture. So there's a lot of change happening as a result of it, and that certainly made it more difficult for these countries to effectively host the refugees, and as a result, many went to Europe. So it is a driver, absolutely.
Rose, did I see your hand? Did you have a chance to ask her? Would you like to? No? Tom, Sam.
Well, this August, around the 18th, the Open Movement Environmental Working Group on Nuclear Disarmament, 168 nations decided that we need an end to nuclear weapons, and they are going to come to the United Nations session and try to pass a treaty that the Security Council cannot veto that would ban nuclear weapons in the world.
Well, thank you. The question is a new effort that's being made by a variety of countries in the context of the General Assembly to ban nuclear weapons from the world, and 168 countries coming together. I think it's long overdue. It's something that, discussed in the U.S. extensively and globally. And it's a passion for my ultimate boss, Ted Turner, who founded the United Nations Foundation, and as well as, of course, CNN, you cannot talk to Ted without him discussing nuclear disarmament. So he's passionate about it. The UN Foundation is passionate about it. And it certainly will require years of negotiation and discussion. But boy, if there's ever been a case where the pursuit of nuclear weapons is a complete waste of money and does not provide the security that people think it provides. When you think about it, all the challenges that we have dealing with terrorism and the threats posed by terrorism, how does nuclear weapons, it only exacerbates it to have nuclear weapons. So I think that there will certainly be extensive debate in the UN context about this issue, and we need to keep plugging away at it and hopefully have a administration here in the U.S. and a Congress in the U.S. that's open to some creative thinking about nuclear disarmament in a way that they haven't been in the past. So thank you for raising it.
If you don't know, around that, would you like to say a word about the Iran nuclear deal?
Sure. That was a controversial subject. The Iran nuclear deal, we were part of the coalition that was supporting the Iran nuclear deal. Not because we're under any delusion that the Iranians will necessarily be 100% trustworthy as it relates to everything that's in that, but because we believe that any time that you can try to negotiate these issues, any time that you can try to find a common solution in a measurable way to move countries away from the nuclear brink in a measurable and verifiable way, then that's a good thing. Now, we'll know 5 years or 10 years from now whether this agreement worked. But we know that what we were doing, which was isolating Iran, was not working. They were continuing to pursue their nuclear program. And they were pursuing it successfully. Everybody agreed that they were pursuing their nuclear program successfully. So, in any event, the agreement that was negotiated, I believe, has some potential with measurable benchmarks to show that Iran is, over time, not further accelerating its nuclear program and is giving up some elements of its nuclear program. But it's going to require constant vigilance, constant diplomatic pressure. And if 5 years into this, Iran is not living up to the terms of the agreement, or we're not living up to the terms of the agreement, I mean, at the moment, we are. We delivered, money that was owed to Iran, we delivered to them, which is, not always a fun thing to do. So we've been living up to our end of the agreement. We need to make sure that Iran lives up to its end of the agreement. And if 5 years from now it's not, then we'll have to consider other options. But at the moment, this is a decent negotiated solution to try to move Iran away from the nuclear brink. It's worth a try from our perspective.
Let me just offer folks a chance for graceful exit. We still have 15 or 20 minutes more for questions, and I see a lot of hands, but some people have noon things or have to get to the lunch, this or that. So if you want to leave now, we won't, raise eyebrows or anything. How about right over there?
An issue that was spoken about years ago at a much higher level is population control. Okay. I had to ask, actually, Dr. Sloan here was in Paris, and he's been raising his hand. I would be interested in his question. But I had to get it out of him whether population control was discussed in Paris as one of the causes of global warming.
Great, thank you. So the question is, to what extent is population control being discussed in the UN context, and in particular as it relates to the Paris Agreement and climate change? I think that it's a core element of the discussion around why the Paris Agreement mattered. I think that the language has changed a little bit. The issue is still there. How can you work with women to make sure that they have access to voluntary family planning so that they can limit the number, timing, and spacing of their kids as they wish to do? Because one of the things we know is that actually if you give families the opportunity to create the size of the family that they wish, that in fact, the type of reduction in the global population over time will occur. And so one of the things that we're committed to at the UN Foundation is we have an initiative called Family Planning 2020. And the whole goal of Family Planning 2020 is to meet half of the unmet need for voluntary family planning around the world by 2020. And we are already making enormous progress towards that end. Here's how it needs to get done. You need to change policies around the world that makes it difficult for women to get access to voluntary family planning. You need to make sure that the new technology, which is long-acting, injectable, family and reversible family planning, is actually dispersed widely throughout the world. And when you actually meet the legitimate need for reproductive health care, that type of impact in terms of population will happen naturally. And so we don't use the term control because it implies that it's us trying to control others. At the moment, we have so many women that want to make their own decisions about the size of their family. Let's let them do their what they want to do. If we go that way, I think we'll have the type of impact that we want to have.
We'll always do this, but since George was mentioned, George, what's your question?
Well, I wanted to comment on two things Peter said. First of all, regarding Mary's question having to do with the impact of climate change on what we might call environmental refugees. This is a very serious problem. The Defense Department, our own Department of Defense, in its last two quadrennial reports, the most recent of which was in 2014, the one before that in 2010, both of those quadrennial reports cited climate change as a serious national security risk for this country. The reason being, the changing climatic factors affect the water supply, basic necessities of life, food supply, coastal areas, sea levels rising, displacing freshwater aquifers along the coastline. These are serious drivers of environmental migration, you might say. And when that happens, it destabilizes the region, the economy of the region, and it destabilizes the population and the country. And so that's why our Pentagon, Defense Department, has cited climate change as a serious national security risk. Of course, its report has been ignored because many of our politicians, and I won't mince words, the Republican Party does not even recognize the reality of climate change. So this brings to focus the importance of vote as though the world depends on it, because it really does. That was my main. The other thing on population growth, it's all about empowering women. It's about empowering women worldwide. I just got back from 2 weeks in South Africa. And one of the local guys who was working with our group, his first name was Nelson, although he was not incidentally named for Nelson Mandela, but he was a very knowledgeable local guy from the Swazi tribe. And he said, he was talking about Donald Trump, as much as I told him that interfered with my digestion. And he said, you know, if Hillary Clinton is elected in the United States, it will be an inspiration for women all around the world and be an uplifting.
Peter's getting ready to answer that. Let me put on deck to Madison people. I'd like a question for Madison after Peter's done with this one.
Great, thank you. The first is about the Defense Department and how it views climate change and more generally the national security implications of that. And the second is empowerment of women at the core of demographic and population issues. On the national security side, I think things are changing. I think that the days on the Republican side, for instance, where you could get away with denying climate change are rapidly changing.
Yeah.
In part because, you know, it's one thing as an esoteric issue, but it gets to this issue that I mentioned earlier about we're actually seeing the impact of it. If you represent a coastal district or anything or an agricultural district, you ignore climate change at your own political risk. So I think things are changing over time, and I think the national security implications and the national security frame is a pretty important way
to reach new audiences. So I think you're onto something. I don't think that that type of thing has been discounted and ignored. I think there's rumblings that there's new people that are coming online about solutions on climate change. And on the subject of empowerment of women, that's why we have our Girl Up initiative. We strongly believe that you have to empower women, starting with their girls, to feel comfortable in their power and feel comfortable in their futures. And most importantly, you've got to keep girls in school. Because when girls go out of school, they get married early, and when they get them married early, they start having kids at 14 and 15 because they're married. So, anyways, it all comes together, but I think the empowerment of girls and women is the absolute solution to making sure that they have control over their reproductive futures.
All right, so let's bounce to Madison. Question, Jan's had his hand up, and then Rose after him.
Yeah. Okay. Peter, your tenure at United Nations Foundation and Better World Fund is roughly coincided with the Secretary General's 10 years. And I wonder if you could reflect a bit on his relationship and the importance he sees about a nationwide group like the United Nations Association. He's spoken to us, I know, at the national level a couple of times. I was very proud that when we celebrated the 70th anniversary in San Francisco, that he was given a special award at San Francisco Pride. So thinking maybe specifically about the affinity groups, the LGBT rights group, the UNA Women group, and his commitment to these issues. Could you talk about how he's worked with us and intersected in that work?
Well, you stole my answer.
Okay.
The question is, how does the Secretary General view the United Nations Association as a partner? And San Francisco was the best example. When there was, he wanted to celebrate the 70th anniversary of the UN, he came to us at the UNA and said, please organize. Okay. So we put together an enormous celebration of the 70th anniversary where we had ambassadors from various countries. It was in San Francisco City Hall. There was, 500 people there. We had the leadership of the UN there. And it just so happened, by luck.
It's Pride Weekend.
Good luck. That it was the morning of the Supreme Court's marriage equality decision.
Yes.
And so we were in San Francisco, and we have a Secretary General that has picked LGBT rights as one of his top priorities. And so it was a darn good morning.
Yes.
And lots of happy people in San Francisco, as there should have been. And so we were, but he, the Secretary General views the United Nations Association as part of his American team. He knows who we are. He knows who all of you are. If you were to ask him where, are there American supporters for the UN, the Secretary General of the UN would say, oh yes, there's UNA chapters around the country. They're very actively speak out. He knows about it. So we already have a plan to make sure that the next Secretary General, whoever she is, knows about it as well. And we, the new candidate that's being talked about, I hosted her for a dinner in Washington, so we're already on top of it. We guarantee that the next Secretary General will know who all of you are.
Thank you.
So, Rose will be next, but just on that, they've had a huge growth in membership of the UNA nationally.
Double.
And a lot of them are young people coming in from various colleges. We see them at the National Convention, and I'm going to be a little bit here today. Once again, students can join for free. And so the membership blanks are just back there. That would be great. Folks that are willing to chip in a little money for membership. These things do cost some money to promote, so we would urge you to join us, or at least put a buck or two in the can back by the food. And Rose is next.
One of the outstanding achievements was UN Security Council 1325. Security Council Resolution 1325. On women, peace, and security. And that has really made a difference in countries in Africa where there was conflict. Women organized and helped reduce the conflict, eliminate the conflict. And the women said, you're our sons, our brothers, our fathers. You need to come together.
Well, the question is, about UN Security Council Resolution 1325, which is Women, Peace, and Security.
and how it's had a transformative impact around the world. I couldn't agree more. And when you think of, it's so interesting, sometimes in the US context, the sort of lexicon around UN resolutions isn't picked up. Very few people know about the Millennium Development Goals until recently. And in fact, you know, we did some polling that showed that like 11% of people knew what the MDGs were, and I think 9% of them thought it was Miller Genuine Draft. I think that 1325 is well known around the world and has galvanized the gender, women's community, and the girls' community to think about the impact of women on the resolution of conflict, because that's ultimately at its core, right? The two things I want to mention is the UN has deployed female-only peacekeeping units. There is one in Liberia, and it's particularly important because they serve as a bridge for civilians, for women who have been assaulted and who can actually have a conversation about what's happening in their community with women peacekeepers as opposed to male peacekeepers. And the second issue gets back to South Sudan. If you put most of the women in South Sudan in charge, we would not be having this mindless conflict. But instead, it's two men making decisions about oil wealth and mineral wealth, and it's not a decent one in the bunch that is running that country. I just hope that the women in South Sudan take charge.
On the matter of the UN growth, like I said, we've had some really good sessions here, and so we you all become members. The crowds are much bigger than they used to be sometimes for these UNA things. So thank you all for coming. We've got a bunch of great programs coming up. Mary, you're going to see him at lunch, so I'm going to pass on you. But let's go over to another Madison person.
I want people to hear this. I just have a comment, and that is. That, you know, you mentioned most of the refugees are from Africa, Mr. Young, but that's where climate change is the worst in the world.
Oh, I see. Oh, you're right.
A little follow-up there.
That's all. You could have a question.
That's all.
Yeah.
So Barbara, you're next.
I have read in the paper that the majority of refugees worldwide are children. And so if you could speak to the demographic profile of refugees and disavow the myth that refugees are drug addict men toting guns trying to get to the U.S.
I agree. I guess my feeling is that when you look, for instance, at when families are resettled here in the U.S., and I had a nice conversation with our judicial candidate who was resettled here with her family, and the refugees that come to the U.S. are almost entirely people with kids, and they have been forced out of their homes. They can't go back. They're not going to be able to go back. So almost every refugee that comes to the U.S. is coming as part of a family. As I said, there are 16 million refugees from Syria, of which 6 million are kids. And that number is growing. Almost 50%, because that number is growing, because one of the things is that when people are in refugee settings or IDP settings, that frequently they don't have access to reproductive health services, and there's nothing else to do. And so people have kids. And so when in the refugee settings, the birth rate can be quite high. But when you look at who comes to the U.S., we have the toughest screening in the U.S. A friend of mine is the Assistant Secretary of State for Population. She works very closely with the Department of Homeland Security. It takes 2 years minimum to get people screened in a refugee camp before they can come here. These are highly screened. We make sure that they have not been part of violence. If they were part of violence, then they're going to go someplace else. They're not coming to the U.S. I think the other point to remember is, I'm 3 generations out. You know, my people came from Norway. I guarantee you, we weren't welcomed. Nobody welcomed us in Boston when we showed up. You know, and so my entire family is from various parts, came here from someplace else. So I think if you look at who is coming, these are people that we want in the U.S. And when you look at the Syrians, these are highly educated people. I mean, you know, Syria, that's the tragedy of Syria, is that it's a very, very successful nation. The people that are refugees are doctors, lawyers, nurses, accountants, highly trained individuals. All the cream of the crop's left, and they want to come to the U.S. and Europe. The Germans are smarter than us. The Germans. Yeah, we'll take them. You know, the accountants and the doctors and the lawyers, yeah, bring them on in. So, I mean, it doesn't mean that we have to work tremendously hard to make sure that refugees are settled into the U.S. But and well integrated into our community.
Well, I agree. Now, part of the National UNAID program on refugees is to support schools that can help people in places like Kenya, where we're losing a whole generation of people that are refugees that don't have sufficient education going on. So they're making a national push for that, but it's a kind of a two-stage or a two-aspect process. There's the helping the folks that are abroad, the folks that do make it to the U.S. that come through the most intensive screening in the world, to welcome them into our midst. And we'll be talking about that at least at the December event, but if folks wanted to earlier, we'll give a little time for informal chatting with Peter after this. So that isn't about it. We'll take those three more questions in a row and then give Peter a chance to do the grand finale, and then we'll break. So, well, I'm thinking people that haven't asked before and aren't on the board. So, all right, so Art, and then here, and then there.
So I wonder if you could comment on an item that was in the news in the last month.
For which I would say the UN gets an A+ for transparency and probably an F for substance. And that's the report of children victimized in war that was listing Saudi Arabia for bombing of civilians in the Yemen, over 1,000. And then Saudi Arabia said they would stop funding the UN, and so the report was then withdrawn. So again, invite anyone to mention that and said what happened. So it's great for transparency, and as Oxfam said, it undercuts the very core of what the UN is supposed to be for. Any comments?
Yep, I got that. Well, let's take just three in a row to make it to speed it up at the end here. So somebody put it to over here. All right, go ahead. Yeah.
A statement of gratitude. This is a really engaged group, and and your clarity and your answers are fantastic. And I just think we need to celebrate. This is actually fun to engage in dialogue in this kind of way on a Saturday morning here in Milwaukee, where we're connecting to the national scene. So, bravo! Thank you.
Thank you. All right, one more from in front here.
The first question is what made us create the foundation, and then the first question related to a report that came out about children armed and hurt in conflict and something that happened related to Saudi Arabia. Why we created the foundation was, it's a funny story. Ted Turner, who was created a very famous TV channel called CNN, wanted to give $1 billion to the United Nations, and the United Nations couldn't take the money because of its own rules. So he created the United Nations Foundation to support the UN and what the UN is trying to do. So that's where we came in, was we are designed to work closely with the UN. And one of the most exciting things that happened was about 6 years ago, we at the UN Foundation entered into a sort of a new partnership with the United Nations Association. So the United Nations Association and the UN Foundation have now been working together for 6 or 7 years, and it's been awesome. So, but it was ultimately created because one man had a vision that he wanted to support the work of the United Nations. On the issue of the report that was going to list Saudi Arabia for its violence against children, in the context of their ongoing military operations in Yemen. And then ultimately the Saudis went to Ban Ki-moon and said, well, if you list us, we're going to cut off all assistance to the United Nations, and we'll show you. So the Saudis are just a wonderful group to deal with. You know, I agree with you that on the substance level, the omission of Saudi Arabia, of course, is a complete black eye, right? How can you issue a report that eliminates the fact that Saudi Arabia is indiscriminately bombing communities in Yemen and killing kids? So how can you eliminate it and still say that it's a substantive report? You can't. Here's the upside. Because the Secretary General said, fine, you're going to threaten me, it's out. And by the way, I'm going to have a press conference. So frankly, the report would have gotten not a lot of attention. And the Secretary General, because he made a big stink about it, it got a ton of attention. It was like leading. So, you know, Saudi Arabia threatens to blackmail the UN over this. So it ended up getting far more attention because of the Saudi Arabia ham-handedness. But I agree with you. In an ideal world, they would have kept it in and still made a stink. And that certainly would have been a solution. And having worked with the Saudis before, they would have certainly cut off whatever assistance they're providing to the UN in terms of helping kids. But it's a difficult situation. I agree with your sentiments. And I definitely get your point. To your point about the nature of the dialogue, from my perspective, this has been wonderful to be back, to be part of this type of dialogue about global issues. And you know, one of the things, it's exactly why we entered into a partnership with the United Nations Association, is because it allowed us to have this far more in-depth conversation with people around the country and communities around the country about global affairs and why engagement with the world matters and why the United Nations matters. Before we had this partnership, most of our conversations were either in DC, in New York, or online. And online was a good place to be, still is a good place to be, but like the world depends on it. But this type of more interaction is so important. And when we do the UNA lobby days, it ends up being the best lobby day we do each year. So back over to you.
Great. Peter Tumadas, he actually helped put together the foundation and the UNA, and there's sort of our own triad at the national level of groups that support the UN and its goals and involve people at the grassroots here. So we've got a pretty darn good combination to try and give at least a good shot at that. Peter's family may not have been welcome in Boston, but he's sure welcome here. He did a great job. Let's give him one more hand.